सो लास्ट क्लास येस्टरडे वी हैव सीन द यू नो द डेफिनेशन ऑफ मार्कोव प्रोसेस राइट. सो कैन यू टेल मी दैट व्हाट आर द थ्री मेन रिक्वायरमेंट्स टू कॉल अ रैंडम प्रोसेस अ मार्कोव प्रोसेस. हाउ डू यू आइडेंटिफाई?
Sir, can you repeat your question, please?
What are the three main requirements for any random process to become a Markov process? There are many random processes, right? Not all of them are Markov. There are certain processes that are Markov processes, right? So what are the requirements it must satisfy in order to be called as Markov process?
Probability of being in a state only depends on the previous state. It doesn't, the probability doesn't depend on the history.
So basically any random process, how do you express any random process? By using random variables, right? That is the way to represent a process, by using random variables. Now, in order to say that these, you know, the some random variable is following a Markov process, so what it should satisfy? So for example, earlier we have, you know, in the last class we have seen, we have defined this xt, x0, x1, x2, right? So these are the different, these random variables, part of the Markov process. So what they should satisfy? So this xi depends on what? Only x I minus 1, right? And affects only x I plus 1, isn't it? So this is called Markov property. So this is first requirement, right? What is the second requirement?
Stationarity.
Stationary.
The probability does not depend on
does not change with time. Very good. That is the stationary. Now there are certain processes with non-stationary distribution, but we do not cover that in this course. There are certain processes, Markov processes with non-stationary distribution. But here we are, you know, focusing on the traditional form of Markov chain with the stationary probabilities. Okay. So here, second is a stationary distribution. Stationarity, right? And what is the third one? One is the initial state x naught should be certain. So this is the traditional, you know, Markov chain. So these three, if you observe these three properties, so x naught is certain means you exactly know where the taxi is at the, you know, start of the day, right? So generally we call it Markov chain if it satisfies this. Now this is stationarity and certainty about x naught can be relaxed sometimes, but Markov property cannot be relaxed. So Markov property is the core property of the Markov chain, right? And stationarity and x naught certainty about the initial state you know, these are sort of, you can say, secondary properties of Markov chain, but they can be relaxed and it will lead to different variants of the processes, right? Now, last day I have asked that, so we have seen that, you know, we can express the distributions, because whenever we define the random variables, we must also define its distribution, otherwise random variable doesn't make any sense. So we have to clearly define the distribution of x0, x1, x2 and all the others. So how did we define the distributions? We took the help of the transition matrix, which is coming from the transition diagram. And the beauty of the transition matrix is it fully defines all the distribution of XTs, that means all the random variables in the process. How? So if we assume that X0 is certain, then it's okay. I mean, you already know what is the value of X0, right? Suppose I want to define the distribution of X1, then how do I define it? How did I proceed? In order to define the distribution of X1,
we were seeing the first row of the transition matrix.
Yes. And why is that? Because what is X1?
The state which will be at time 1.
Time 1. So it can be either at 1 or at a state 2 or at a state 3. That means either if the taxi can be at the you know, airport or in the hotel or in the downtown, right? It can be either of the three states. So in order to completely define the distribution, we need to assign values to all these probabilities, right? Or a mechanism to get the values for all this, right? So first probability would be X1 is, you know, assumes state 1, given X0 is at 1, right? Second probability is X1 assumes value 2, given X0 is 1. Third is X2 assumes value 3, given X0 is 1, right? So these three probabilities completely define, so when I say completely define the distribution of X1, why I'm saying completely? Because there is no other possibility. It cannot go to any other state. It cannot assume any other state, right? Only one of these three states. So if we are, if we can give a mechanism to compute these probability values, we are done. We can define the distribution. And we have shown in the last class that this can be obtained directly from what? From the transition matrix P, isn't it? So here, because the initial state is 1, so the first row will give these probabilities values. So similarly, we can define the distribution of X2. How? By again, you know, giving this probability. I mean, we have to compute these probabilities, right? These three probabilities. X2 is 2, given X0 is 1, and X2 is 3, given X0 is 1. And we have shown in the last class that these values will be given by, again, by the first row of what? E square, right? Because it's the second step probabilities. You see, X2 is 1, given X0 is 1. So I have jumped, I have skipped one step, right? So that is why it is called second step probabilities. So second step probabilities will be, can be computed directly from P square. And this is the derivation we have already shown in the last class. Are you clear up to this point? So similarly, I can see for n step probability. So in general, if I say xn, what is the distribution of xn? Can you tell me? What will be the distribution of xn? What will give the distribution of xn?
First row of p power n.
If x0 is 1, right? So simply we say that you know, n step probability matrix or transition matrix is nothing but the matrix multiplied n times. So this is the notation, this is how we write it. So in the left p, in the bracket, in the parenthesis we have written n. So this means n step transition matrix p, right, is equal to p raised to n, which means this matrix multiplied with itself n times. And if x naught is 1, initial state is 1, then the first row will give you the distribution of xn. Similarly, you know, if x naught is 2, then you'll read the second row. Okay, so what we have observed here, that this transition matrix, the concept of transition matrix and its you know, this mechanism, I mean, this n step transition matrix can be quickly computed in this manner. So this has helped us to define completely all the distributions for all the random variables. So given a random given a Markov process, if you have certain variables, so if you can simply compute this p, that is the initial transition matrix, then you can compute all other transition matrices. So you do not need to explicitly compute them unless necessary, but you can simply say that this p gives the distribution of all the random variables, right? Is it clear up to this point? Any question? This is a very important concept, basic but very important, fundamental to understanding Markov chain. Okay. Markov process is also known as Markov chain because it looks like a chain, x naught, then x1, then x2. So if you recall the realization of the process, it looks like a chain. So that is why it is also called Markov chain. Now in the last class I asked you that, you know, suppose I relax the property that x naught is certain, that the initial state is known. Suppose we relax it. So earlier we were assuming that taxi will always start from the airport, but suppose we relax it, we do not know. It can start from any place, right, out of these three states, of course, right. And I assume that it is equally likely. So which means that so this is given. So probability that it will be at a state 1 and P2 at a state 2 and P3 at a state 3. So this you can consider as a, you know, row vector, right? So this is given as 0.33, 0.33 and 0.33, right? Equally likely probabilities. Suppose this is given. So in general we call it P0. So this is the, say, row vector that is given, you know, P0. Sorry, it is actually the column vector. So if you take the transpose, it will be row vector, P0T. So whenever we define a vector, it is always a column vector, right? So I have put T here so that it becomes row vector. Okay. So this is given. So I asked you to compute. What did I ask? What was the question? Last class, at the end of the last class. What was the question?
probability distribution of xn.
No, not xn. Specifically, I have given something. I think x2 equal to 1 or something like that I had written, right? Okay, forget it. Let me ask this one, right? Suppose I want to know this. What is the probability that x5 is equal to 2, which means at the end of 5 trips, it will be at state 2. State 2 means downtown or whatever it is, right? So what is the probability? How do you compute it? So if x0 were known, right, with probability 1, that means if it were certain, then I could have easily computed it from here.
So first we'll compute as usual p to the power 5 and mm-hmm. then we'll take its second column and do dot product with this vector which you give.
Mm.
So that will give the probability.
Right. So in general, if I compute this p5, so p to the power 5 is the 5 step transition matrix, isn't it? So from p5, what it will look like, again, you know, it will be, so this matrix will be like this, 1, 2, 3, and then 1, 2, 3, fine. And there will be some values here, right? Some values here in p5. Suppose p is given to you, p will be given to you, definitely. So then you can compute this p5, so you will have this transition matrix, okay? So then what's next? So which means, suppose if x0 initially, if it is 1, then this first row would have given you the distribution of x5, right? So x5 is 2 means this middle one would have been the answer. But we do not know whether it has started at 1, right? It has started at 1 with probability 0.33. So how should we proceed? As he has said, we have to do the dot product, right? Because see, with 0.33, this is the chance, this middle value, right? Then again with 0.33, this second thing, and with again 0.33 for the third state. If we started from the third state, then this one. So this column corresponding to, you know, the state 2, because we are interested to know x5 is 2, right? So let us define these columns. I mean, in terms of probabilities, how do I write this first one? This first one is p12, right? p12, but fifth step probability. So this column vector I'm just writing. So this is p12 in terms of mathematical notation. And this one is p22, and the next one is p32, right? So this is the second column of p5, and we know p0 with this. So if we make the dot product, so it will become, so this answer lies here, p10, p12 plus p20, p225 plus p30 and p325. So essentially what we have done, we have considered all the possibilities, all the initial states that are possible with the respective probabilities, and we have simply multiplied with the fifth step probability for state. So this value, if we compute this value, it will give p x5 equal to 2. So this is known as the state probabilities, okay? This is known as state probability. And these probabilities they are independent of the initial state. Okay, so it has a particular name, state plurality. So in general, in terms of notation, you know, this p x y equal to 2. So in terms of notation, we call we denote it like this, p 2 and then I. Right. So instead of writing p x 5 equal to 2, I can simply write p 2 5. So p 2 5 means fifth step probability. So whatever is in parenthesis, it denotes the state. So fifth step probability that the of being at a state, right? So x 5 is equal to 2. Okay, so this I write p 2 5. This is the state probability is equal to this. So in general, I can generalize it, right? That for any state I, and for any step n, there are two things, state and step. So in the parenthesis, this is step. Okay, and here in the subscript, this is state. So what does it mean, PIN? It means probability, tell me, XN is equal to
I.
Isn't it? Yeah. So this is the notation, just notation. So now you know how to compute state probability. So far we have, what you have learned? You have learned how to compute the state probabilities and also the state probabilities. So let us take an example and try to compute all these things from so I am just reading out one problem, an example problem. So you try to model it as a Markov chain and try to answer the questions. Okay. So the problem is the customers, the same problem I'm giving you, you know, this taxi problem. So there are three locations, airport, downtown and hotels. So here I am giving you some conditions and some data, because see, in order to compute the transition matrix P, you will need data. How will you collect the data, for example, for this problem? So you will observe the travel behavior of this taxi for a long period of time, maybe, you know, 1 month or 2 months. You will collect the data, and from that data you will assign the probabilities along the edges, I mean this transition probabilities, right? So after, you know, observing the taxi travel behavior, you have seen the following. The customers starting at the airport never go to the airport again. Okay, and are equally likely to go to downtown or to the hotels. So this is one observation, travel behaviors, you know. So please note it down, huh? Customers starting at the airport never go to the airport and are equally likely to go to the downtown or to the hotels. Now next observation is, those who start from the downtown area divide equally among the destinations. And the third one is, the ones who start from the hotels go to the airport 2/3 of the time and to downtown 1/3 of the time. Three observations, you know, you have made from the data that is collected. So first one, I am again repeating, customers starting at the airport never go to the airport and are equally likely to go to the downtown or to the hotel. So try to draw the transition diagram from this statement. And then the next observation is, those who start from the downtown area divide equally among the destinations. And the third one is, the ones who start from the hotels go to the airport 2/3 of the time and to downtown 1/3 of the time. So these three observations are given to you. Please draw the transition diagram, form the transition matrix, and answer this question that what is the probability what is the probability that it will be in downtown at the end of two trips. So this question is asked, what is the probability that the taxi will be in downtown at the end of two trips? So you have the calculator, so please solve this problem and tell me the answer.
What is the initial position?
Initial position is nothing is given about that. Question asked is what is the probability that it will be at the downtown at the end of second trip.
So 0.388 is the
answer. Yes. Yes. Very good. So how did you proceed? So you first have to draw the transition diagram, right? Who else has done it? So it says that the customer never goes to the airport, right? I mean, starting from the airport, so there is no self loop at one, right? Equally likely to go to downtown and hotels. So say this is airport, right? This is downtown, and this is hotel, right? So equally likely to go to downtown. That means this is probability half, and this is half, right? And then what is the next? We start from the downtown area, divide equally among the destinations. So this is again half, and this is again half, right?
Sir, it should be one third,
right? There is, because there is a self loop, right? So one third, and then the third observation is the ones who start from the hotels go to the airport. Two thirds of the time. So this is two third, and to downtown one third of the time. So this is one third. So this is the transition diagram you can construct from the given observations. So you can easily write the probability matrix also, P, from this transition diagram, and compute P square. So that is the second step, probability matrix, which is P square, right? Okay, so this P square, now how to answer this question, that at the end of the second trip, it will be at state 2. So I am asking this question, what is the probability that x2 is 2? So basically initial state is not given, which means this is a state probability, right? And we know how to compute the state probability. So because 2, so I'll take the second column, state 2, right? So I'll take the second column of this P square, which comes out to be 0.33, 0.389, and 0.444. Just check. Is it correct?
Yes, sir. It's correct.
Yeah. And I have assumed that it can, you know, equally likely this event, that it can be at the airport or downtown or at hotel, right? So simply again dot product, so you will get 0.389 for this. Okay, any question? Suppose if I would have given you the information that what is the probability that x2 is 2, given that it has started from the airport, then what would have been the answer? What would have been the answer?
0.333.
So I see, if I do not give that information, here the probability slightly increases, 0.389 now, right? If I do not give that information, why is it happening? Why the probability is increasing? Think about it. Or is it like just like a coincidence or some random thing, and which is not true for, you know, other cases? So you just compute px2 equal to 3 also, and px2 equal to 1 also, and see if you are getting the same thing or different things, and let me know if there is any pattern, then why that thing is happening, and if there is no pattern, then okay, it's fine. Okay, so now we are able to define the Markov process formally, mathematically. So this is how, so far what we are seeing is known as discrete time, discrete state process, right? Discrete time, discrete state process. Now, discrete time is understood. We are considering first trip, second trip, third trip. So it is discrete. We are not considering 1.5 or, you know, fraction. So this is understood. Discrete state process, which means it can be either of the one states. It cannot be half, you know, 0.5% it occupies some state, 50% it occupies some state, 50% another state. So this type of thing is not considered here. Okay, so it can be only at one of the states at a particular point of time. Is it understood? So that is why we are calling it discrete time, discrete state process. Similarly, continuous time processes are there, continuous time Markov chains are there, which is known as continuous Markov chain, which we will not discuss in this course, but that because that's an advanced topic. But many, if you look at many practical applications, mostly they are discrete time and discrete state process. But there are some continuous processes also, especially observable in chemical industries, chemical processes. So now formally we define mathematically the Markov chain. So probability, so a random process is called a Markov chain if this is true. Probability xn, so nth, this xn is a random variable, for state, at epoch n, right? So it assumes certain value j, jn, given all the other, past states are known, say xj n minus 1 is jn minus 1, xn minus 2 is jn minus 2, like this, x naught, the initial state is j naught. Okay. So if this is given to you, then if it is a Markov process, it will be xn equal to jn given xn minus 1 equal to jn minus 1. So it only depends on the previous state, not the other states, other past states, right? So this is what we have already seen. So mathematically I have just put it here. So, and regarding the transition matrix, we know also the stationarity of the distribution, of this probability values. So Pij, so Pij is one element, say ijth cell of the matrix, right? So I can write it as x1 is j given x0 is I, right? So I to j, this probability. So this remains the same for all the states. So xn is j given xn minus 1 is I, or any other, xm is j given xm minus 1 is I, right? So this is a stationarity property for the one state probability, right? Okay, I think it is clear, because these all we have intuitively we have understood with that example, and now I am just writing it in mathematical terms. That's it, nothing new. Okay, and another important observation we have seen is P, the n step probability matrix, it can be written as n minus 1 and p. Sorry. Okay. Now this has a special name. So two scientists, Chapman and Kolmogorov, they have found for the first time this relationship. So it is called Chapman-Kolmogorov equation. We have already seen this, that how you, when you are say computing the distribution for x2, you have used the distribution of x1 in order to arrive at x2, right? So you are using the just immediately previous transition matrix in order to compute the current transition matrix. So we have seen that. So this equation is known as Chapman-Kolmogorov equation, and you know some variants are there. Like it is not about only immediate, so you can also write, and this can be mathematically proved also. But I'm not going through all those proofs. So intuitively we have to remember, you know, n minus m and pn. So these transition matrices, they have this property, okay, and also P raised to n is Pn. So these three, you know, they are the, you know, same equation, Chapman-Kolmogorov equation, but in different forms. Okay. So the beauty here is that, as we see, that this transition matrix, it behaves like a constant quantity. I mean, if I write x5, you know, is equal to x3 times x2, right? This we know. The same thing is happening for the matrix. So that is the beauty of it, actually. And similarly, in order to compute n step probability matrix, you have to just multiply this matrix n times. So this third equation is also very familiar with us, familiar to us. And the second one is especially interesting because it looks like this P is just behaving like any other variable, like x, y, isn't it? And the first is also we have seen earlier. Okay, so just remember these properties of the transition matrix and how strong and powerful and beautiful it is, right? And this is especially true for Markov chain. Because of the Markov chain property only, this transition matrix behaves like this. Clear? Any question?
No, sir.
So now we will go to classifications of Markov chain. So one thing you must have observed, that when we were discussing this linear program, integer program and all those things, essentially we were taking some decisions, right? Something was given, some constraints, and you know, objective was given, and we were taking the best decision, the optimal decision. Okay, that will satisfy the constraints and you know, achieve the objective then. But here, as such, there is no constraint or there is no objective. Here we are studying a process and analyze the process and answering some questions, that too in terms of probability. So it is not a very, you know, concrete decision that we are making, although it is called, it is within the purview of operations research, but as such, it is not a decision science, you know, it is more like predictive science, you can say. What you known as predictive analytics, right? And you will see that maybe in other courses where you learn this machine learning and other things, you will also learn hidden Markov models. How many of you know hidden Markov model? Anybody has heard of this term, hidden
yes.
Markov model?
Yes, sir.
Right. So this Markov process is more like answering the questions with the help of probabilities, right? So it is more like a prediction, that I am giving you this prediction with this much confidence, you know. So it is more toward that predictive science, whereas the earlier topics, linear program, integer program and all those things, transportation, assignment, all those things, those were more like prescriptive analytics. So analytics is basically three things. One is descriptive analytics, you know, that covers the statistics, you know, descriptive statistics. Second one is the predictive analytics, where you want to predict in future, right? So these belongs to the predictive analytics. And the third one is prescriptive analytics. Prescriptive means there is no ambiguity. If a problem is given, these are the constraints, this is the objective, and that will be the optimal solution. Right? There is no ambiguity, no uncertainty about it. And you have to take that decision and you have to implement it. So that is called prescription, right? Prescriptive analytics. So optimization in general, it is known as prescriptive analytics. Whereas Markov chain and machine learning and all, you know, some parts of statistics, they belong to predictive. Okay, so now we will see there are many types of Markov chains that can be there, and we'll try to learn that what are the different classifications of Markov chain. So I am drawing one Markov chain. You just observe it, how I am drawing. So these are different states. And suppose I have this transition diagram. So this is suppose a Markov chain given to us. This is the transition diagram, and some probabilities are attached to these edges, right, to these arcs. Now you observe, interestingly, suppose it has a start, it starts from some point, say here, this is the starting point. Then what can happen? Suppose these are the different states. That means different locations the taxi can go, right? So what will happen? So if it goes through this, you know, it comes to this state and this state and this state. So it can come back to this starting point again, right? And in fact, it has to come back, isn't it? Suppose it leaves and it comes here, then it has no other option but to come here. And then it has no other option but to again come here, starting point. Do you follow this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, suppose it has left other, you know, toward the other direction. So here. So here, from here, it will go here, and then here, and then here, and then here. But it cannot come back to the starting point, so it will keep looping here, isn't it? It can never come back to the starting point. One, it has followed this arc. So if it decides to go from this starting state to this state, it will never come back to the starting point again. Right or wrong?
Yes, sir.
So what we have a special term for, you know, this type of Markov chain. It is called irreducible Markov chain. What is irreducible Markov chain? Suppose if I consider only this subset, only this one. Only this subset you consider. Irreducible means you cannot reduce the Markov chain. Okay. Reduce means, so it cannot get caught within a subset of states. So an irreducible means all the states, there will be always a chance of visiting all the states. If at any point it gets caught somewhere and it cannot visit to some state, then it is called reducible Markov chain. You can break the Markov chain in two parts and can study them separately.
Sir, then this is an example of reducible chain, right?
Yeah. No, no, this one is irreducible, okay? This one is irreducible, this part. Again, if you consider this part, this is again irreducible. But the, as a whole, it is not irreducible, right? Okay? As a whole, it is not irreducible because you can actually break into two parts, two irreducible parts, basically, right? So as a whole, it is not irreducible, but if you consider this subset, they are reducible. They are irreducible. So what is the definition of irreducibility? That there will be always a chance of visiting a state, no matter where the current state is. Fine? Is it okay? Okay, so the time is up. So we'll continue this, irreducibility and its significance, that why it is important to define irreducible and how it helps us. And we will see other types of Markov chain like recurrent Markov chain, transient Markov chain, periodic, aperiodic, many types are there. And we'll see examples, practical examples that, you know, how to classify these chains and what kind of insights we can get from these different types. Okay.